positions are threatened, or their role is threatened, or they don't. Did you see that person that came into church yesterday? Oh, I did. What kind of attitude is that? Church, listen to me. God has a plan for this church. And the plan is not to harm the church, but to prosper the kingdom. The question is, will we get on board with it? It's not just about Pastor Chad. It's not just about the board. It's about all of us coming together and doing what is necessary in order to win men and women and boys and girls into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what we're to be all about. This is what I believe. I believe that we have prayed. And this pastor and this family is an answer to that prayer. And now God is saying, what are you going to do with it? I've answered your prayer. What are you going to do with it? I believe with all my heart God wants to build this church. I believe that God wants to fill this sanctuary. So much so that you have to do something about it. I believe that God wants to do some incredible things. As you grow this church, you know what happens to your community? It begins to change as well. See, when people are being won into a relationship with Jesus Christ, the scripture says if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old is gone. Behold, all things have become and are becoming new. How do you transform your community? One soul at a time. One person at a time. By loving them. Church, I believe that God has given you a great leader. The question is, will you join with Him? Will you join with Him in building the kingdom? In a few moments, you're going to enter into a covenant. You're going to share your board secretary. Did you get that? Okay, good. Just want to make sure. Thanks, Pat. He's going to, the board secretary, on behalf of the people of the church, they're going to read their part of the covenant, your part of the covenant. And pastor's going to share his part of the covenant. Now, there's no kissing of the bride at the end of all this. Just but understand that, what was that? Oh yeah, we've got the missile. Yeah, my wife pointed that out right away. But we're entering into a covenant, a promise made before God, asking for His blessing and His anointing and His leadership, that together He might use us for the building of His kingdom. Amen? Amen. Does everybody have one of these blue sheets? Wait, let's do a wave offering. Everybody should have one. All right. Pastor, Heather, I'm going to ask if you guys would both join me up here, please. Thanks, Wayne. If anybody doesn't have one, hold your hand up. I want you to have one. This is really crucial. I do want you to have one. You may need them. You better grab a stack. Thanks, guys. I want to make sure everybody has it before we start. There we go. One, do the wave offering. Come on. All right. Good. For 20 centuries now, get this. Read this carefully. For 20 centuries, in every generation, the church has set aside some of her members for special training and preparation, ordaining them to serve as clergy. She elects them to positions of responsibility, not privilege. They are to serve the needs of the church. These ministers give up their lives, so to speak, for their lives are not their own. They serve if, when, where, and in the capacity that the church invites them to serve. They are the servants of God. The early church referred to them with words which meant table waiter, under rower, slave, priestly servant, and shepherd. Additionally, the minister today is seen as pastor, leader, and one who casts the vision and enters into this vision along with the congregation. The church ordains only those whom they believe God has called to such service. Pastor, will you accept the charge to be the spiritual leader of this flock?
I will.
Congregation, will you, the members of this church, accept, support, and uphold your pastor as he leads you?
Yes.
Renee, I'm going to ask you to come and to read the congregational covenant on behalf of the congregation, please.
Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together as pastor and people to be workers together for your kingdom. As we labor together, we will support our pastor with respect, loyalty, love, and consistent prayer. We will accept his family with love and will hold them up with encouragement, affirmation, and prayer. We will give sacrificially of our time and means so that our pastor can be relieved as much as possible of the temporal cares of this life, thereby allowing him to give his full attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. We will endeavor to respond positively to his pastoral leadership by active participation in the congregational life of the church as it carries out its fourfold mission of worship, evangelism, nurture, and service.
Thank you, Amen. When Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, he took the towel and wrapped it around his waist and began to wash the feet of his disciples. He was setting the example of how we are to respond to one another. Pastor Chad, on behalf of the Pittsburgh District Church of the Nazarene, your district family, I present this plaque or this sculpture to you. It's called The Basin and the Towel. And I love this piece of artwork because it is a constant reminder of how we as pastors and shepherds are to serve our people. As Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, you are to serve the people of God as well. I encourage you to put this someplace in your office where you will constantly see it and be reminded, first off, of the prayers of the people of the district, the love of the people of the district, but more importantly, the love and responsibility that you have to the people of the Titusville Church of the Nazarene. And you get to keep it this time. I'm going to invite Pastor if he would come and to, or you can do it from there, do your covenant to the people of God here.
In response to the gracious call of God and the gratitude for the confidence that you have expressed in me, I receive these symbols of pastoral leadership and pledge to you a stewardship of these resources and a covenant with you to make ours a living, effective church. A church in which sermon and sacrament are based strongly on the Word, vitalized with dynamic presence of the Holy Spirit. A church with the atmospheric expectations of conversions. A church where the tempted are surrounded with victory. A church where the redeemed are enabled to see their larger need for Christ and cleansing fullness. A church where the particular consolations of God are given to the afflicted. A church where Christian men and women begin, even on earth, to be authentic Christian community. A church to consistently witness to the whole world with sacrifice in its heart and single-mindedness in its purpose. I pledge to you a stewardship of my responsibilities as pastor, to live before you with integrity and Christian simplicity, to responsibly administer the affairs of the church in consolation and cooperation with the church board, the church staff, and the people in the congregation as we carry out the work of the ministry for those edifying the body of Christ, to lead you in worship as a worshiping leader, developing a careful regime of study, prayer, reflection, and preparation for the purposes of personal growth and ministry, to encourage you, to comfort you, to instruct you, to challenge you by the preaching of the word and the administration of the sacraments, to seek always in all appropriate ways to expand the borders of the kingdom of God, cooperating with the district and the global church of the Nazarene and fulfilling a worldwide mission, to live responsibly my roles as a husband and a father, giving to my family the care and the love due to them as gifts of God to me, to listen carefully to you, care deeply for you, to work closely with you, to pray daily for you, that we may grow in all things together, who is the head of Christ, and to be a servant leader after his example.
Pastor, having committed yourself to this work, I charge you to care and to care alike for the young and the old, the strong and the weak, the rich and the poor. By your words and by your life, proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Congregation, since you have willingly and prayerfully called your pastor to work among you, I charge you to willingly and prayerfully support, cooperate, and work together with him in the name of Jesus Christ, whom you both serve. I'm going to ask the congregation if you would stand with us as we join in the mutual covenant between pastor and people. We shall strive to cooperatively create and sustain
an effective ministry that will renew and strengthen each member of this community of faith. We shall actively seek and welcome into membership all persons with regard to their economic and social status, race, or nationality. We shall accept our responsibility for moral and spiritual development in our community, living by Christian standards of citizenship. We work together with our churches and denominations in our community for the advancement of Christ's kingdom, wherever we have the opportunity to do so. We shall periodically evaluate our church's fellowship and ministry in light of our mission. If problems present barriers to mutual effectiveness of pastor and congregation, we shall cooperatively pray, faithfully communicate, and work in love to find solutions in the spirit of Christian understanding. We shall work to ensure the church appropriately relates itself to the mission, institutions, and doctrines of the Church of the Nazarene, and the redemptive mission of Christ in our community, our nation, and our world. Amen.
I think it would be appropriate. Joseph, would you join your mom and dad up here, please? Church board, I'm going to ask if you would come and you would gather around this family. Church board, come if you would. I want you to gather around this family and place your hands on them. I'm going to move this so that you, some of you can come up here and stand behind you. And because, as I said earlier, it's not just about the pastor and it's not just about the church board, I'm going to ask you, as members of this congregation, if you would come and also lay hands on your pastor as we pray for him and his family today. Come if you would. Gather around. By the way, I think this is a good thing to do periodically. I know that we pray for our pastor often in our homes and in our prayer closets and things like that, but sometimes I think it's just good to get together and lay hands on our pastor and their family and lift them to the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus Christ, we come before you. Lord, thank you for your faithfulness to us. Father, you are always, always, always faithful to us. Even in the midst of our faithlessness, the scripture says that you are faithful. Yes. And Lord, I know in my life and probably every life represented here this morning, they could testify to that fact. You are always faithful.
Yes.
Lord, thank you for your blessings. Thank you, Father, for the ways that you have worked in this in this process of calling a pastor. Lord, in this process, you have made it known to all those involved, from the board all the way to the congregation. Lord, you have made it known what your will is, and your people have responded affirmatively. And so, Lord, today we acknowledge that you are in the center of all of this. It is you who have saved us. It is you who sanctifies. It is you who causes good things to happen in and through our lives. Lord, we come to you boldly asking today for your blessing upon this pastor, upon his family, upon this board and this community of faith. Lord, that you would pour your Spirit out upon them in such a way, Lord, that they could not help but be used of you to build the kingdom.
Yes.
It's not about us.
Yes.
Father, we've never, ever been able to lead anybody to Christ.
Yes.
But you working in us, I've seen it happen over and over again. And so, Father, that's what we pray for today. We pray boldly for an anointing upon this pastor and these people. Lord, that you would be alive in them in such a way that people who do not yet know you would want to know you.
Yes.
Because of what they see.
Yes. Yes.
And what they hear in the hearts and lives of these people. Father, thank you for the promise of your word, that you will build your church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it.
Amen.
Father, build your church here in the Titusville Church of the Nazarene. Father, build your church throughout this community. Lord, may this be a beacon of hope, of life, and love. Father, thank you for what you've done in the past. Thank you, Father, for all of the pastors that have served so faithfully this congregation and this community. As we stand upon their shoulders today, we pray that you would do it again.
Yes.
Do it afresh and anew. Not for our honor and glory, but for your honor and glory. We pray these things in Christ's name, for his sake. And all God's people said,
Amen.
I want to share, as you're working, make your way back to your seats if you would. I want to share something that I just received yesterday from Dr. Bob Broadbrooks, who is he's in charge of the church in North America and Canada. An interesting statistic at the end of the year, I just received him yesterday. For the Church of the Nazarene in the USA and Canada, he lists the top 10 churches, the top 10 districts, I should say, in regards to evangelism, the number of people won to Christ in any given year. Can I just tell you how excited I was as I looked through that list to see, in regards to the increase in number of people being won to Christ, the Pittsburgh District Church of the Nazarene was number 4 on that list. Okay? You know what that says to me? We're doing the work. We're doing what God is calling us to do, and He is blessing that. But there's so much more work to do. Amen?
Amen.
By the power vested in me as a superintendent of the Pittsburgh District Church of the Nazarene, I declare to you that you have committed yourselves to mutual covenants, and I hereby install Pastor Chad as the pastor of the Titusville Church of the Nazarene. As a new pastor and congregation, you have entered a meaningful and solemn relationship, that of pastor and people. May the Lord bless and strengthen and guide this new time of ministry for this church, for this pastor, and for his family. May God's peace, may God's love, may his joy fill you as his people, his body believes, in such a way that next Advent season there will be enough seats here to contain the people won to the kingdom. May you know his peace and love and joy in that intimacy that you would make it known. God bless you. Thanks for the privilege of being here today and to install officially your new pastor. I'm not coming back for a while. It's not that I don't love you. But I've been looking forward to this for a long time. Pastor, thanks for being willing to come and be a part of our team. We're looking forward to great days. Would you officially welcome your pastor, please?